Welcome back, everybody. So this week, we're going to talk about the concept of post-colonialism and animality, which is a considerable field. And I bring in a lot of really interesting examples for you to think about. So I think the first thing we should do is cut straight to it, because I do have quite a bit of examples. So I don't want this to go too long. So let's just cut straight to it and get to some terms. I teach a class on post-colonial art. I can't remember if any of you have taken that class with me. I don't think so, actually. So there are some terms that we really need to know before we can start addressing the specific issues of animals in the history of colonialism and post-colonialism. And so, of course, one of the key terms would be the history of colonialism itself, which is tied to a history of exploration, tied to the history of Western exceptionalism and the expansion of European empires over the past 400 years or so. So it's a form. The definitions I give you on screen are from post-colonial textbooks. So we won't go through every single part of this, but it's important to keep some of these things in mind. So the term colonialism is defined as a set of cultural exploitation. It's not only the exploitation, let's say, of natural resource and that sort of thing, but it's also exploitation of culture, of the social as a whole. And so you had many early civilizations that had colonies. Think back to the Roman Empire. There would be colonies with viceroys and this sort of thing, but the colonies themselves would be somewhat left to their own. They'd be allowed to do within reason, live the way they had. They would just come under the rule of the Roman Empire. Colonialism is more than this. So we might have a distinction between, let's say, this older form of imperialism and settler colonialism, something Edward Said talks about. So rather than ruling something from a distance in an imperial setting, colonialism activistly goes in and expropriates, actively comes in and takes over, enslaves, exploits, and settles on this distant territory. So you have this whole history of the West, of the European West, of undertaking what they called the civilizing mission. So this idea that going around exploring and colonizing people was part of the civilizing mission of the world, making these quote-unquote primitive peoples, barbaric peoples around the world, become civilized, which usually meant entering into a white Christian worldview. So that, roughly speaking, very, very broadly, is what we mean when we say colonialism and the act of colonizing, which again goes back to the time of exploration by the British, by the Spanish, the Portuguese, the French, the Dutch, so on and so forth. So post-colonialism is something that happens after colonialism, after a state has been decolonized. So the process of decolonization happened in the course of the 19th, but especially 20th centuries. So think of India and Pakistan in 1947, where they become independent. That's when they become two states. They become independent from the British. Or think just a little bit after that, in the beginning in the late 50s, the civil war in Algeria and the Algerians getting their independence from France during a struggle of decolonization. So once you're a formally colonized state, you're no longer colonized. You enter into what's called a post-colonial period, and there's a whole area, a whole domain of academia and of discourse that talks about what it means to be post-colonial, what post-colonialism is, which really starts becoming galvanized from the 1970s forward. Decolonization, some say, is actually an ongoing process. That even within post-colonial situations, or even within a colonizing, a former colonizer, like in the United States, there are still moments, there are still features of culture, of the economy, of politics, that need to be decolonized. And so some will argue that calling a situation post-colonial has jumped the gun, that in fact the process of decolonization is something that is in some ways continues to be a work in progress. And the other really important term for this then is this idea of neo-colonization, neo-colonialism, the new colonialism, which was a term coined by Kwame Nkrumah, who was the first president of Ghana. And he described this as the type of, in some ways, we might now call it soft power, but the ways in which states will rule other states in an asymmetry of power and asymmetrical economic relationships. So think of the World Trade Organization, the IMF, multinational trade agreements, and multinational corporations, this sort of thing, that on paper now, we have states in the world that are sovereign, they're autonomous, they're post-colonial, they're no longer part of, let's say, the French state or the British state or what have you. But nonetheless, because of the process of colonization, all these mechanisms of power were left behind. So this is well known, especially in Africa, that even when the French left, they left these bureaucrats behind. They left corporations behind that worked with the new power, the new local post-colonial power, but kept certain inequalities, kept certain forms of exploitation, especially the exploitation for resources and minerals and so on and so forth. The Congo is a nightmare in this case. And so this type of power that still gets wielded through the economy, through diplomacy, not through war, not through settler colonialism, but a type of power that can be exerted over other states through mainly economic channels and multinational corporations and trade agreements. This is then called neocolonialism. Okay? So this will be an important term for our class today, because there's so much, there are so many forms of neocolonialism that degrade the environment and that have an impact on both domesticated and wild animals. So this will be a really important term for us. But all three of these terms are important. Colonialism, post-colonialism, decolonialism, and neocolonialism. It's all a mouthful, but they're very important. They're very important terms. And so I can give you an example of an artist, really wonderful artist, who just had a show in New York last year at the gallery at Baruch. Mexican artist Minerva Cuevas does this type of work that tries to call out neocolonial forms of power, neocolonial forms of violence. So this was Del Monte. It's a riff on Warhol in some ways. If you know Warhol, Warhol did soup cans, did Brillo boxes, used a lot of these commodity, these objects that you would buy in a store in the 1960s and 1970s, and then used them and to make silk screens and, or in some cases, like recreated the Brillo boxes themselves as works of art. And so in some ways, this work is tapping into that pre-pop, that prior pop language of a Warholian type. But this is more of, this is a far more critical work. This is what, in my other class I just taught today, we might call culture jamming. So she's using the aesthetic and the visual vocabulary of Del Monte, of this large agricultural entity. And I think she's spelled it differently, right? Del Monte, I think it only has one T. I guess this is a legalistic thing, right? You don't want to use the exact title. I might be wrong about that, though. But what she definitely did is that instead of having in these tomato cans, you know, pure pureed tomato or whatever it might be, each one says pure murder. And this really starts to get you thinking about these objects, these agricultural objects that look pristine and beautiful and wonderful, and you can go and buy them, and then you can make a spaghetti sauce with them. All of a sudden, you start thinking of the labor conditions and where these tomatoes actually came from, how they were harvested, what are the economic deeper conditions that made these objects in a store possible. And this artist is very is adamant that in fact a lot of these labor conditions are exploitive, and that we have neo-colonial forms of power on other states. The list could be endless. So underpaid work, long hours, outsourced to places that are cheaper, where you don't have labor laws and regulations. This is really just the litany of the complaints of the dark side of a globalized economy that's able to outsource labor in a way to cut cost and usually put people's lives in precarious situations. So this would be a prime example of a work that goes after neo-colonial forms of power. So, you know, the example would be, I'm not exactly sure where Del Monte comes from, but let's say bananas that are grown in Guatemala, or how about the avocado example? These avocados that are grown in Mexico that may very well now be run by drug cartels. You have these economic channels that exude a certain amount of power on the local population, but they suit the importer, right? So I don't want to get too far down the rabbit hole of neocolonial power, but this is a prime example of that. So no longer ruling, let's say, a Latin American country through a junta and through a government takeover or a coup, but now in some ways controlling it through the economy. So this is just a good example, economy and goods and supplies and natural resources. So what does this all have to do with animals, right? With the more than human world? Well, more recently, there's a promising collaboration between post-colonial theory and animal studies and the ways in which animals and their representations play or continue to play a role in colonial and post-colonial and neo-colonial histories and transactions. And this is not without difficulties. This is not without friction. And so the response that I asked you to write for today comes from the Critical Terms for Animal Studies, the post-colonial entry. I think does a really wonderful job going in and talking about how this can actually be quite a fraught territory. This can actually be a fraught relationship. Animals, non-Western humans, let's say the West that in some ways continues to play coercive or powerful roles over both. So it'll be really interesting to read your responses. So post-colonialism and the more than human world, actually there's quite a bit there. Almost everything we talk about today are going to be examples of artists that work in this niche. Actually, I shouldn't call it a niche. Work within this very large history, because I think we often think that world history is basically between human societies. So in the case of the history of colonialism and neocolonialism, post-colonialism, you have Western humans that come in and have taken over non-Western humans and populations. But in fact, through and through, nature and non-humans play considerable roles in this history. Even though they themselves didn't write the history and don't know that they're in the history in the way that we do, they nevertheless play an indelible role within that history. So a lot of scholars today have been trying to go back and research how non-human agents, non-human entities, like animals, play a considerable role in the formation of history and the power, especially between different societies. So that's the major, those are the big stakes of what we'll be talking about today. So some possible themes would be the history of colonialism and domestication. That's going to come in. The history of colonialism and hunting and zoos, especially like trophy hunting, this kind of thing, that's going to come into what we talk about today. The subjugation of non-Western peoples and animality. So this is where things get very complicated, very very tricky, because on the one hand, we're going to be talking about animals as something to care about, in some ways as something to respect, as something that's important within history and within culture. And on the other hand, we have a history of non-Western peoples being animalized themselves, so human beings being deemed to be less than human being, in an insulting sort of way, in a way to degrade them, in a way to make pseudo-biological arguments that, let's say, non-white people are in some ways not as evolutionary advanced as white people. There's a whole history of this, of the animalization of other peoples, which is nefarious, which is wrong. So when we talk about the animal in history, then all of a sudden we're in a very tricky place, because on the one hand we want to advocate for animals, we want to understand the importance of their role within history and culture, and on the other hand we definitely don't want to reinforce negative stereotypes based off of racist or prejudiced recourses to calling other people less than human, who in fact are human, as a way of exerting power over them. So we're in fraught, very tricky territory. And again, I think this chapter in the Critical Terms for Animal Studies, the Postcolonial Entry, I hope you find it interesting, and I hope the author brings out these dynamics in a really interesting way. So again, I'm looking forward to hearing about your thoughts on this. We also have endangered species, which we're going to talk more about next week when we talk about the aesthetics of extinction, and the way the sixth extinction is being in some ways made visible or thematized in contemporary art. But already here, we should talk about it in this lecture too, because the way in which species become endangered, often it's in places that it's in non-Western locations. So I think the one place in the world where you have the extinction rates going the fastest of any place in the world would be in the Brazilian Amazon. So this is not some force of nature that's leading to this mass extinction that we're seeing. These are mechanisms of neocolonial power. So we're going to talk about that today too. And then lastly, what can actually be quite interesting are to study what non-Western schools of thought, non-Western philosophies, or non-Western spiritual traditions, what their views on nature and animals are, which are often very different from Western conception of animals. So in this class, it's a welcome class, because it broadens the conception of what we even mean by animals, of what we even mean by animality. Because I think we sort of fall into this trap where, even if we're talking about animal rights, even if we're talking about ecofeminism, even if we're talking about all these things we've been talking about throughout the semester up to this point, we're still working with a conception of the animal that's Western. That's the weirdest part of teaching this class and being and researching this topic, which is what I do in my own work, is that the more you think about it, the more you research it, the more you study, the more you realize that you're not actually even sure what you mean by animal, by what that word means. And the more clear it is that actually what you do mean by the creature or the animal or animality is a historical power, is a historical construction in some ways, and for us one that's, for most of us anyways, one that's quite Western. But there are different conceptions of animality. So animist traditions in Latin America would be a very different conception of the animal, one that's flies in the face of the history of animality in the West, right? So it's very clear how opening up the scope of the debate towards non-Western views of nature and animals is a post-colonial gesture, or a decolonizing strategy within our own language, which we're speaking right now, and we're in New York City, which is based in a Western tradition. So broadly speaking, this is what we'll be talking about today with examples. And I wanted to bring in this old painting called American Progress from an American painter, John Gass, from 1872. And it shows you Manifest Destiny, westward progress, right? The railroad, agriculture, so on and so forth. The personification of Manifest Destiny and this woman sort of floating to the left. Notice then this scene that looks like it's just this optimistic, wonderful new world kind of aesthetic. Notice we have two groups here who are being chased out. We have Indigenous First Nations people being chased out, right? And you also have bison, so wild animals also being chased out. So you're seeing this allegory of Manifest Destiny, of Western progress, and technology, and everything that's part of this very moment in the modernity of the West. You're seeing it play out from right to left in this painting, and notice how it's going from lighter to darker. It's as if you're seeing this quote-unquote civilizing mission unfold along the face of this canvas. And so what's interesting, of course, is that today we go and we see that this is not some kind of inevitable or natural thing that happened, that these savages, quote-unquote, needed to be displaced or needed to be civilized, right? We actually now see this as a type of occupation, but probably. We probably see this as an act of violence, as an act of occupation. And then the same goes with the bison up at the top. So what you're seeing unfold here is a conception of humans and nature as one of mastery, as one of domination, and the way we talked about last week with ecofeminism. And this is the type of relationship with nature and animals that we're only beginning in the West to reconsider. But in 1872, this would have just been an unconditional, an obvious, just good, right? So it's very interesting to look at a painting like this, which is very famous, very celebrated painting, and to see these post-colonial, this pre- and post-colonial interplay happening on the face of the canvas. We also have someone like Walton Ford, who's a wonderful painter, and I'll show you more works of his next week, because a lot of his paintings have to do with endangered species and extinct species. And so what he does, this is one of his early works, he does these really rather beautiful paintings that seem to harken back to a much, much older time, a much older representation of animals. So John James Audubon, you probably heard of Audubon before. He was an actual explorer. He went about documenting and setting up a taxonomy of animal life in this country. And the thing that that his works don't show is any human presence or his presence. So you just seem to have this timeless, beautiful depiction of an American flamingo, so from 1838. But it's devoid of people. It's just as if it's this pristine, natural setting. But of course, that's not how it really happened. Because of course, if you're going to go around exploring and taking specimen from the natural world, you're actually actively altering. You're having an effect on nature. You're having an effect on animals, and you're having an effect on the land. And so, what Walton Ford does is he kind of corrects this. So he gives you the beautiful American flamingo, almost as if it's a moment after, as if these are photographs. Like this is like 5 seconds before this one. Because, of course, Audubon, from a distance, shoots the flamingo, gets the flamingo so then it can become stuffed, it can be studied, and so on and so forth, right? So Walton Ford is actually showing you that moment of violence within this history that I think can fairly be called a history of colonizing nature, of domesticating nature, and bringing it within a Western discourse of exploration and of science and of documentation. So Walton Ford's really interesting in a number of ways, and I'll show you more works of his next week. We also have someone like Silda Morales, Brazilian artist who did this installation called Missions Missions, How to Build Cathedrals from 1987. Oh, I'm sorry. It's an immersive installation, so you walk in. It's all behind black. You're sort of submerged within this black drapery, black curtain that goes all around. So when you walk in, it's an installation where on the bottom here, it's all coins. This is all coins, currency. Then in the middle here, you have almost like this ladder that's going up to the ceiling part of the installation. And those are wafers. So think of hosts. I was raised Catholic, so I remember this part of the Eucharist, the part of the Mass where you would get a piece of bread, or the host, the wafer, which for Catholics, for Christians, represents the body of Christ. So these are all wafers stacked up on each other, kind of, you know, this kind of stairway to heaven sort of thing, connecting the bottom part of the installation with the top part of the installation. So you have currency, you have economy, the economy, you have religion, you have the wafers, and then the ceiling, maybe you can't quite tell what it is, but these are all cow bones. They're lit, they're backlit or lit from underneath. They're suspended on the ceiling. These are all cow bones, like the bones of the like the tops of the femur and the hip bone. So like the biggest bone of any mammal's body. Our femurs are our strongest and biggest bone in that we have in a body. And so these are like the heads of those suspended on the ceiling. And so it's a pretty dramatic installation that thematizes three things which are very, very important for the history. Again, he's Brazilian. The very, very important for the history of pre- and post-colonial Latin America. So, of course, money, the economy. So the reason why you had all these missions, explorations to go to Latin America, to go to this country, all those centuries ago, was in part to get natural resources, was to get spices, was to get minerals, was to get gold, was to get the goodies, right? So the value at the level of currency is at the bottom of this installation. Then the history of religion and the history of Christianity and all this. Because of course the history of colonization, the history of these missions weren't only missions to go get land, to go get stuff, but it was also an attempt and a hope to convert the rest of the world to Christianity, right? To turn these quote-unquote heathen, pagan, primitive people into civilized Christians. All that obviously in quotes, because it's an incredibly problematic history. So the wafers themselves then probably represent religion. And then on the top, what might be less obvious, but played a huge role, would be domestication, would be livestock. So one of the things that the West, that Europeans brought throughout the world, which most other places in the world had not thought to do, was large-scale domestication, especially domestication of animals for meat and for milk. In Latin America, it was virtually unheard of to for indigenous peoples to mass domesticate animals. And this very much has to do with the way in which animals were conceptualized in their understanding of the world. In many animist traditions, animals are fellow travelers or spirits, are in some ways on par with the human, sometimes even superior. So if you go out and kill or eat one, eat a wild animal, you're sort of taking, the conception is that you're tapping into sort of this spiritual communion with nature, so that to get one and to raise it, domesticate it, keep it in containment would go completely against the conception of this animal as this wonderful thing, as this wonderful force in nature. So when the colonizers came to Latin America, a place like Brazil, but also Mexico, and lots of other places in the quote-unquote New World, they brought with them their livestock. There's a new film coming out by the director who did, what was the name of that movie? Lucy, It's about a girl with her dog. I'm blanking on the name of this movie, though. I hadn't thought to talk about this, but it's just coming to me right now. I'll put the trailer on the website after I'm done recording this. But this director has a new movie about the first cow that was brought over. It's called, I think it's just called First Cow. So I'll show you those trailers. Some should be interesting movies. So the reason why this is so consequential is that once this livestock was brought over, historians go back and they understand that one of the ways in which, advanced civilizations like the Aztec were decimated really quickly, one of the reasons is that they didn't have the same immunity that Westerners had. So in the West, in Europe, there's a long history of domestication, of being around domesticated animals like pigs and like chickens and like cows. And so Europeans develop immunities. But this is not so if you've lived in a place that's never domesticated cows, that's never had these domesticated animals. You don't have an immunity to the pathogens, to the zoonotic diseases that come from domestication. And so things like cowpox and smallpox decimated non-Western populations. So this is one concrete way in which the animal, this is in a grim, violent way, but had a consequence, had shaped the way history and the meaning of these human societies unfolded. So if you're interested in this, there's a wonderful book by the anthropologist Jared Diamond called Guns, Germs, and Steel, and his argument is that the three things that allowed Europe to conquer other parts of the world were guns, was steel, and then the germs that came along with their livestock. So it's a really interesting history, and it seems like Silmarillion is tapping into this history of the economy of religion and then livestock through this installation, Missions, How to Build Cathedrals. And then, of course, this brings us forward to what used to be something I had to explain a little bit more when teaching, but now we're all going to know exactly what I'm talking about. And these are pandemics that come from domestication, that come from large-scale, in some cases not large-scale, animal agriculture. So in Argentina in 2009, there was a terrible swine flu pandemic that ravaged the country. And so here is a collective that, a graffiti collective that had a pig with a mask commenting on the swine flu, pandemic. And so I think now it's more or less second nature. I gave you that article talking about zoonotic diseases and how the coronavirus, or COVID-19, likely comes from wet markets in China. And the use of wild animals. But this is where we have to pull back and make sure that we're not in some ways sort of essentializing, let's say, Chinese wet markets and saying those are bad, but then packing millions of chickens in one large space in South Carolina is fine, right? No, if we're going to criticize a wet market in China, we have to criticize all forms of domestication and of confinement that can lead to these zoonotic diseases. So even leaving aside the ethics of treating animals in this way, just the desire to not have another pandemic like this, and experts, a lot of researchers say basically all pandemics are zoonotic. They've all come from animals. They've all come from conditions of domestication and confinement. To be just to try to do away with these in the future, we have to reconsider confinement of any animal. The ones we consider to be edible and domesticatable, or the ones that people in places that don't live where we live consider to be edible or wild, and that sort of thing, right? So be it a bat, a chicken, a cow, a pig, if they can lead to zoonotic diseases, We should reconsider the whole history of domestication. So again, this used to be something that was somewhat far-fetched, not far-fetched, but a little bit more complicated to talk about and to address in a lecture. But we're living it now. We're definitely living it now. So I think this is in everybody's mind, and it's very clear how animals, again, in a negative example here, are affecting human society and affecting human history, so much so that it's affected the whole economy. And of course, what is it now? 3 million people have been infected, and thousands have died. It's something to keep in mind. Then we also have, this is again in Buenos Aires, there's a nice tradition of street art and graffiti in Argentina, and this El Marian. And this is a more general take on animal agriculture and neocolonialism. So we're going to talk more about this likely next week, but for sure when we talk about ecology, animals and ecology. One of the key things to note is that in Latin America, in just the Brazilian Amazon alone, some 80 to 90% of it, 80 to 90% of deforestation is either for grazing livestock or for growing soy that will then be fed not to humans but to livestock. And of course, these are big multinational beef corporations, right? That are in good with both, unfortunately, United States lobbying, but also the Brazilian government. And now we have Bolsonaro, who's a pretty far right wing president, one who advocates the three B's: the Brazil, the Bible, and beef. This is like one of the logos, one of the themes of the Bolsonaro administration: beef, Bibles, and Brazil. So we have a situation here where you have large corporations, large entities going in, taking over land. In some instances, it's pretty depressing, but killing activists and displacing indigenous populations that live in the Amazon and depend on the Amazon for their sustenance and for their livelihood. And we have people who are undernourished, who there are famines in the world, where we could, in fact, instead of growing soy to then feed to cattle, we could use that land to grow food for humans that are in need, right? So this too is part of this history of colonization and neo-colonization. Animal agriculture, I think, is a huge mechanism of neo-colonization, especially in Latin America. And so this artist makes it, I think, very, very clear, where you have these rows of cows eating soy, eating grain, and then this young boy who's looking destitute, who's looking famished, just sort of left off on the right, on the road. So graffiti is usually quite activist, and it's very, very direct. So there's not really that much to interpret, other than sort of the political economic context here. And I think it's very clear how it taps into the theme of animals in the history of colonization, and these neocolonial industries that are taking such a toll on you know, if you add this to the equation of climate change, it's taking a toll not only on local people, but on everybody, on all of us. So there are moves to decolonize your diet, which is quite interesting. If you're interested in this, just look it up. I think there's now a whole cookbook called Decolonize Your Diet. And it is an interesting thing to think of the history of the Western diet. It's sometimes called SAD, Standard American Diet. SAD, I guess, maybe is a fitting acronym. With all due respect. So the idea that the way in which the West, especially people in the United States, eat, that's been in some ways outsourced to the rest of the world. And so you used to have places like Okinawa, you used to have places that had some of the healthiest, most long-lived peoples now developing diseases, now developing, let's say, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, certain types of cancers, this kind of thing, right? So it's weird, but it makes a lot of sense. When I first thought about this, I thought, oh, this is incredible. But it is very possible that diets can be forms of colonization. A diet can be a form of power, especially when we're talking about, you know, ultra processed and very cheap fast foods that are clearly not good for either the humans or the animals involved, that these things are promoted and outsourced all over the place. It's quite an interesting way of thinking of the diet. So there are now movements to try to decolonize diets, to try to go back and get away from this sort of addiction to these cheap, fast, and it is true, highly addictive, processed foods, often based in mass consumption of animal products. There's a pushback. So an interesting thing to think of, just at the level of diet, which of course is related to the larger issue of politics and of industry and the economy, right? And so let me give you some more examples. So now we're going to move, I think, away from the discussion of colonization and neocolonization, and get to some other topics that we had talked about at the beginning of class. So this is a work by Kader Atia. He's a French Algerian artist, and he set up an installation called Flying Rats. And these are little children made of bird seed that he sculpted, and then it's inside like this chicken wire space. This is an installation, and he put in some pigeons. And then, of course, over the course of the installation, the children all start to get picked at and eaten by the birds. In some ways, it's actually quite horrifying. I don't know what you think. And I'm not sure if you've seen Hitchcock's Birds. It's a very classic movie. If you've never seen Birds, you should put that on your list. It's a great American film. This is very reminiscent of birds attacking little children. And so this is, I'm not going to spend too much time talking about this installation because I've written about it and I've thought a lot about it. But there is a way in which Kader Atia is tapping into a certain derogatory language that's part of public discourse. So one at the level of pigeons, which are commonly called, I don't know if you've heard anybody call them that, but flying rats. So the idea that pigeons are vermin in city streets. But then also, especially beginning in 2013, Kader Atia is very much involved with immigration and immigration crisis, and the pushback, and often the racist pushback against immigrants in Europe. And so there's some way in which these birds tap into the racist fears of people living in Europe, thinking that their children or that their livelihood are being in some ways attacked by this vermin coming from other places in the Middle East or in Northern Africa. So it's as if Kader Atia is playing with both the fear of the animal, but then also displacing sort of the fear of the ethnic other into the animal, in a way that might not be without its own controversy. This is a risky work, right? If he's working both with animalizing tropes, both of an animal, derogatory flying rats as pigeons, but then also the animalization of, let's say, Algerian immigrants in France, right? So this is a challenging, pretty confrontational work. And I have a video of it because I think this is something you'd want to see as it's moving, because it's a real-time installation. And I apologize right off the bat, this is in French, and whoever made the video didn't have any subtitles, and I can't find, I haven't found another video that does have subtitles, but really don't worry about it. Everybody is basically freaked out. Some of them say, well, this artist is really sick. Some of them find it kind of fascinating. So it's just a whole range of public reactions to this work. But what you really, I mean, the reason I'm showing it to you is so that you just get to see the installation as it happened. Il était une fois la 8e Biennale d'art contemporain de Lyon. Les œuvres présentées sont parfois énigmatiques. C'est pourquoi nous avons rencontré 5 artistes, puis le public. Ce soir, dernier volet de notre série Gros Plan sur une installation qui fait beaucoup parler d'elle, celle de Kader Atia.
relève plus de la psychanalyse, de la névrose, de la phobie, donc quelque part de tout le monde et de l'inconscient collectif. C'est peut-être pour ça qu'on peut être amené à réagir. Mais est-ce que l'art ne doit pas être quelque chose qui nous sert à ça, justement ?
On va disparaître l'enfance petit à petit et avec les pigeons qui les dévorent, ben on le voit bien, quoi.
J'ai du mal à comprendre. Je ne sais pas ce que ça veut dire. Et en plus, c'est porteur de maladie, donc je vois pas...
Il y a un malaise quand même, un gros malaise, mais ça me fait du bien quand même. Par rapport au... Je trouve l'expo assez linéaire, mais là on s'en prend plein la tronche.
J'avoue que je déteste assez les pigeons. Donc j'ai l'impression qu'ils sont destructeurs, porteurs de maladies, et ça m'angoisse.
On est dans un contraste, et c'est probablement le contraste qui se veut intéressant. L'est-il vraiment? Je ne sais pas. Je cherche.
So there you go, Kadaratia, flying rats. And so the other part of this discussion, here we're basically within a European context, right, of what it means to be afraid of the natural world, afraid of the other, so either the immigrant that gets doubled as a pigeon, or if you speak French, you would have heard a lot of these people reacting, basically none of them talking about immigrants. All of them just focused on the pigeon as a pigeon. But basically saying, oh yeah, pigeons, they're gross, they're carriers of diseases. So there's a certain phobia or a fear of the pigeon. So we're definitely within a European context here, but what happens when we go to, when we leave Europe and we look at the role of animals within non-Western cultures? And so this is a movie called Viringo, which I highly recommend watching it. I know I recommend too many things in this class usually, because I just have so many things I'm excited about. But Viringo is really, really good. I think it's still on Netflix, and it's about a primate great ape reserve in the Congo. And so here's where human history. We talked about the way in which animals have affected human history. With zoonotic diseases, both in the history of colonization and currently. But then what about the other way around? What about when human unrest, what about when human civil wars or human struggle for resources, often violent, what happens when they make incursions on the natural world? What happens when they affect animals? And so what you have in Virunga is this wonderful sanctuary for great apes. During this time of civil war in the Congo, it's harrowing, but you have people protecting these great apes as these important figures within the country. Right? There's an importance in the in their existence, in their well-being. So this is a wonderful film, and I'm just going to show you the trailer.
Le parc national de Virunga, c'est la vie de la communauté. C'est dans cette entité là où vous pouvez encore trouver les gorilles des montagnes. C'est ça ma vie. Ils ont l'amour.
I think that we have a problem.
Companies are exploring for oil. I came here to cover the security situation.
I was sworn in to ensure that Virunga National Park's protected. Oil companies have a reputation for controversial ventures. All their efforts are focused on the national park.
In the past, it has brought a lot of violence here. Everyone wants their slice of the cake.
This isn't a war yet, but it could be soon.
Companies are playing with fire.
Fear has driven people out of these villages.
If we leave, we would lose everything.
The national park is the only hope this region has.
You must justify why you are on this earth.
Finalement, nous serons aussi jugés. Nous allons seulement croiser le bras quand le parc sera en train de disparaître.
Pourtant, notre souhait est que ce parc reste immortel.
This is a really important documentary. I highly recommend watching it. And as you watch it, it'll be clear how all these themes we've been discussing today play a role. And so I think I have, I'm not sure how long I've gone here, hopefully not too long, but I have a few more examples to show you. So Bharti Kaur, an Indian artist, wonderful Indian artist. This is her, the skin speaks a language not its own. It's a large fiberglass elephant. And if you look up close at the elephant, you'll see that it's made up of all these little shapes. These are actually bindi dots, so little devotional dots in Hinduism that you put on that Hindus put on their on their forehead. And these are now one of the interpretations of the work that I've heard is that these bindi dots are now industrial mass produced. Right, so they're something that are mass produced and then sold. And so this elephant, it's as if the bindi dots are not her skin. The skin speaks a language not its own. That it's actually something sticking to her. And I'm not sure exactly why I feminized the elephant, because it very well could be a he. The elephant is seems to be weighed down. Maybe being suffocated by all these bindi dots, these industrially made bindi dots, and can't really get up, can't really recover, and so there's a certain metaphoric resonance here of India itself as having gone through a painful and very quick process of industrialization in the past 20, 30 years, and that leads to these kind of growing pains. And then this loss of tradition, or partly loss of certain traditions, or at least the compromising of certain traditions. So a pre-colonial, colonial, and then post-colonial, more like clash, all converging on the fiberglass skin of this elephant. And I have a video of the elephant for you being unpacked at Sotheby's. So let me just, I won't show you. I think the curator talks about it, but we don't really need.
This is by Bharti Kaur. This is in the evening cell. It's going to take quite a while to get it into the building.
Just so you get a nice sense of scale.
Magnificent work of art, and it's one of the most important sculptures by an Indian artist to come to auction. When I first saw this piece, which was in the Essel Museum in Vienna a couple of years ago when it was on exhibition there, I was blown away by it. I spent 10 minutes wandering around the elephant, and it really stuck in my mind. It's just one of those pieces you never imagine will come to auction. What it is, obviously, is a life-size female elephant covered in thousands of bindis, which have been hand-applied by the artist. It combines two great Indian motifs, so the elephant and the bindi, in one monumental sculpture. Bharti is leaving the viewer to make up their own mind as to what the sculpture is about, but it symbolizes the conflict of tradition and modernity in Indian society. And the elephant, I think, sleeping, resting, or perhaps even dying, symbolizes that. But also with the bindi, you've got this tremendous sense of movement. It's as if the elephant is being either overcome by the bindis or being woken up by them. So the bindis could represent people, for instance. It could represent the people in India, the, kind of, the mass of the population, overweighing the culture and kind of almost smothering it. Or they could represent the booming population, kind of reviving Indian culture and kind of lifting the elephant up again. Back here, you've got the most amazing whirlpool effect, almost, of the bindis. And it's a kind of, it's a traditional bindi in India, but it's one which is mass-produced, obviously. It used to be a kind of hand-applied red daub on the forehead, whereas now it's a kind of consumerist object, almost. And I think that Bharti's work is about identity and culture and kind of India's position at the beginning of the 21st century. I think here she's employing kind of very pop art aesthetic, really, taking not a ready-made, because of course it's not, but the kind of the language which you'd expect from Western art and kind of making it her own and making it a universal language, I think. So it's not specifically Indian, it's more a kind of contemporary work of art.
So I'm not so sold. I haven't seen it in person, so I can't say for sure, but I'm not so sold on the idea that the bindi dots are a mass of people that are maybe going to awaken the elephant. Though it did just occur to me, I think we've just had so much ecofeminism on our minds, that the bindi dots are unmistakably also kind of, they have a spermatoidal, they're like a sperm kind of quality. And it turns out, yes, it is a female elephant. So then maybe there is in some way, there is some way where this mass-produced, industrialized India, if you know anything about the recent history of India, it's also a very, let's say, kind of macho. There's like a macho Hindu nationalist sort of patriarchal kind of conception of Indian society. So maybe Bharti Kaur, by using the bindi dots that have this sort of sperm-like quality that's weighing down, maybe suffocating this female elephant, maybe there's an eco-feminist gesture as well as a post-colonial or decolonial quality to this work. We'd have to do more research on that. I just thought of that right now at the top of my head, but it could be an interesting reading. And so two more works for you. This is, I almost have a hard time pronouncing her name, a Thai artist. She's really wonderful, Araya Rajmanirsukh. This is an installation from Documenta 13 that featured a work called The Treachery of the Moon, where the artist sits with her two dogs, although she has more than the two dogs, but she only took two dogs with her, I think, on the trip to Kassel in Germany for Documenta. She sits on a mattress with the dogs and watches Thai soap operas. And then in the room is projected the images of the actual political situation in Thailand, which has often been very fraught. I mean, there was a military junta. We'd have to do the research on the recent history of Thailand to fully understand this work. But just know that what she's watching is kind of fluffy, fun soap opera kind of TV. That she's watching with her dogs, and then she's sort of then flooded there's this ambient flooding of projection of civil unrest in Thailand itself. And I love this work because the dogs become so central. She's not alone. She's not alone in this saturated space of images. She's there with her dogs. And we've talked so much in this class about what it means to be with a non-human companion, and that what it does to you even physiologically, let alone psychologically. So it's important that they're there as her companions. They're a central part of the work. And she's a wonderful artist, and so I thought I would show you an interview with her talking about this work and talking a little bit about her practice. She also has, in Thailand, she has a basically like a sanctuary for dogs. So the conception of a dog in Thailand is different from a conception of dogs here. If you save a dog in Thailand, you're likely saving the dog from going to market, right? So it would be like saving a pig or a chicken here, right? So she has this dog sanctuary. She has all these dogs that she takes care of. And in many instances, they become part of her work. So she's a Thai artist. She's working within this post-colonial, neo-colonial setting. But I would also say she would be eco-feminist in the way we defined her. We defined this broadly last week. So let me show you this video and this interview with her. It's a beautiful work.
Mm-hmm. Mai, Thailand. I am from a big house and a very big garden and a big group of dogs living together in a very beautiful surrounding and very beautiful atmosphere. We are in the process of being and continuing. Treasury of the Moon is about my daily living, sitting in front of a television with dogs and having something to eat together. It's a family time of home, and it happens in the evening, the time that the soap opera come, and we call in Thai Lakon Lang Khao, fictional drama after news. I mix many stories together. I work very hard by sitting in front of television and try to know every soap opera from every channel. And it brings us the joyful, sometimes with tears and sometimes with anger. If we are so involved with the actor, character or story. Dogs know nothing but what I can tell them. The black one, his original name is Ngap, means bite. But when he went to Germany, he got a novel name like a Prince Jude. It means a prince diarrhea. Because he had accident before and he had a difficulty by doing his private business. The fat brown one names Namtan. Namtan means sugar. Namtan died just 4 days before I came home, and that's the so sad situation that I didn't say goodbye to her. Thai soap opera very emotional. It's in between the private life and political situation, a very bad situation in Thailand. If you get used to your familiarity, and you don't know how it is, then the other comes and tell you something. Then it comes to the point of comparison, and then you can observe or reconsider your daily living, your part, what you're staying with the other that come on that time.
คำว่าเสื่อมย่อมแสดงว่าเคยดีมาแล้วแต่หนหลัง
I love using text at the beginning of Treasury of the Moon. It's from a princess who was in the time of a king Rama VII, and that king have to leave the country. And then the princess has a specific experience to look back and criticize Thailand and Thai people because she traveled and she stayed abroad. And I love that, very direct, because Thai people never say directly, except me, sorry. And the song in Treasury of the Moon is from my father's generation, but he already died, so then I sing the way to heal myself, so to put some old song in that. Yeah, it's about love.
Okay, sorry about the loud noise while you were watching that. I completely knocked over my microphone as I turned it for you to have the sound. Okay, one last work by Tuan Andrew Nayan. My Ailing Beliefs Can Cure Your Wretched Desires. This is a really incredible work. I saw it for the first time. Someone at the CAA a few months back in Chicago presented on this work and showed a lot of clips of it. It's a really powerful work. Unfortunately, I can't really find any videos other than one very small, basically like the trailer for it. But it's a video, it's a two-channel video, one on the left, one on the right. And they go at different speeds, and there are two narrators. One is Mr. Rhinoceros, one is Mrs. Turtle. These are characters from Vietnamese mythologies. And so, and they talk about the natural world. And so the film unfolds. You see all these different animals within Vietnamese society. You're seeing practices that come from the colonization by the Chinese in Vietnam. So a demand for certain animals for Chinese medicine and so on and so forth. You're seeing Western colonization, because Vietnam was colonized by the French, and then of course the U.S. came in and took over the war there, and we had the Vietnam War. So this predilection for Westerners to come in and trophy hunt. So you get all these, this complex network of colonial, neo-colonial powers within this post-colonial state. So the residue of Chinese colonization, the residue of French and American colonization, all wrapped up with these two characters that are going through Vietnamese traditional culture, mythologies, and the conception of the natural world, especially of animals. So it's a really complex, fascinating work. We'd have to actually watch it to see it, to really have a, not that we're ever having conversations, but to have a really nice understanding of the work, we'd actually have to see the whole thing. But I do have a quick snippet of it for you, because the artist does have it on Vimeo. So you get a sense of what it's like, at least one of the channels. At some point, maybe I think you do see two channels, but you get a good sense. It's just a minute of the work. One of the really great parts of the work, I think he works with a composer, and you have this really great music. There's kind of this hip-hop sort of trance kind of quality to this music, and it works really well with the way everything's filmed. You have different speeds. It's a really seductive video. It's a great work. A fair warning, though, there are difficult things to look at in this, even just in this one minute clip. There are scenes of slaughter, scenes of cockfighting, and some other scenes that are definitely can be difficult to look at. But I wanted to show you a bit of it. So that's just a snippet of it. I've actually never seen a work that's been both so beautiful and incredible and incredible to experience, and then also quite harrowing at moments and difficult to look at. And so it's really, in some ways, an emotional roller coaster to see this work. Unfortunately, I don't have the full video for you or anything more than that clip, but I think you get a good sense of what it was like. Of what it's like. So maybe one day you'll see it in a gallery or a museum. All right, everybody. So that's it for our post-colonial session. I'm really looking forward to reading your responses for those two readings. And we will talk next week. Everybody stay well.